Palantir.
Hey, this is not a test. This is rock and roll. Time to rock it from the Delta to the DMZ. Is that me or does that sound like an Elvis Presley movie? Viva Da Nang. Oh.
Today, it's clear that being able to leverage the power of data is instrumental to our collective future across sectors. There's too much at stake in an ever-changing world to settle for fragmented or siloed data landscapes. Over the past year, we've been working on a next-generation approach to data integration. It's the biggest single step forward we've taken since the release of Foundry's original data integration suite.
Pipeline Builder is our new data integration capability that delivers on democratizing data integration while maintaining robustness and security. In short, allowing users to build better pipelines. Let's start from the beginning and see how it's put into action. We're going to work through building a simple pipeline from scratch. We can add any data on a Foundry instance to the pipeline. This data can include tablet data of all sizes, streaming data such as sensor recordings, geospatial data, and telemetry from IoT devices, or unstructured and semi-structured formats such as imagery data, XML files, and PDFs. Here we'll be working with a supply chain disruption.
Welcome back to the channel, everyone. Hope you're all having a great weekend. I am having a lot of fun in Foundry this weekend exploring Pipeline Builder. I want to read a couple of things here. Pipeline Builder is Foundry's primary application for data integration. You read that right. It's now the primary application for data engineering, data integration in Foundry. That's a huge statement in and of itself. And as I'm understanding this tool, I'm getting to see why. We're going to dive into it. We're going to dive into the differentiators and my thoughts on Pipeline Builder that I have so far. I was lucky enough to meet with Kamran, who's the tech lead on this project, the product lead. And he walked me through the system. I was blown away at like what I saw, and I immediately zeroed in on the value of this platform and what it's going to do. And we're going to get into it in a little bit, but Seattle Data Guy has been talking about this a little bit on LinkedIn, which is like there's this huge bottleneck in data engineering right now, and it's actually blocking a lot of high-value initiatives. I'll talk about that later. But when I saw this tool, I was like, oh, man, this is going to empower so many people. This is a 10x empowerment tool. Like I can hand this tool to data analysts and other engineers, and it's going to 10x their skill set. I know this from just looking at it, how it's going to 10x my skills on Foundry. And the other thing I want to read here, too, just so we understand how big this is, Pipeline Builder uses next generation data transformation backend specifically designed to act as an intermediary between logic creation and execution. That's huge. There is a whole domain-specific language that we'll get into, and we'll get into my thoughts on domain-specific languages and their negative correlation with as complexity goes up, usefulness tends to go down. But I believe Pipeline Builder is differentiated here. But this is actually a massive breakthrough. And what that enables, when you have this sort of layer between the specific implementation of the programming language and execution environment that will carry out this data pipeline, and that now you can model that, you can do a lot of really cool things that can empower more software-defined data integrations at Foundry, because you now have this high-level abstraction over a lot of the undifferentiated heavy lifting that went into building these pipelines from code. You can drive those costs down. So like the cost of doing a software-defined data integration can come down substantially, and we'll talk a little bit more later about my thoughts on why that's going to happen and how, and it's specifically by removing the data engineering bottleneck that we're driving those costs down. You can also do things like provide common data archetypes independent of their usage, right? So like I can actually make small, well-defined data archetypes that can then be composed together into a pipeline that would be part of, say, a Foundry archetype. And that actually, people, is going to really help the open source community. So I'm really excited to figure out how I can start building code repositories on GitHub that are an implementation of the DSL, not the GUI, but the actual language that underlies it, this intermediary logic and abstraction that we're talking about. And as if you're an engineer out there, you don't need to be a data engineer. You can come in, you can actually contribute to those things and build archetypes. Someone left a message on my Discord today about the semantic web and its usefulness in how we can do domain-driven design and build applications through ontologies. And absolutely, those kind of things are useful, but I think that in the context of applications, you want optimized data models that let you optimize for your compute resources and your cost, not how the quality of the theory, right? And so semantic web often have these really wide table definitions of like what this thing is when they can actually be simplified down into a much simpler thing and still be a linked or related content type if you want to do that. But in these open source projects, we can start contributing as engineers to building these data archetypes, which can then be brought into Pipeline Builder automatically, just serialized in through an import. And then the customers can take advantage of that, linking their source systems up to these data archetypes and then build the Foundry archetype from that. And what that can enable is every company speaking the same language about their data, which is rocket fuel for mergers and acquisitions. Right? It's like, it's also rocket fuel. And the reason it's rocket fuel for mergers and acquisitions is because system integration is no longer a four-letter word, right? So like systems integration becomes instant and powerful. So I think that if Pipeline Builder helps enable and bring about this future where we remove the data engineering bottleneck, businesses start talking the same language when they're talking about data and use Foundry as a way to like build these consortiums, it's going to be rocket fuel for business. And so I'm really, really excited about the possibilities. And there was one other thing, the back end. So we have with the back end acting as a middleware logic between the creation execution. Builders can solve schema problems before a pipeline is built and save time previously spent on computation and code checks. So basically, there is a set of same defaults turned on in Pipeline Builder. And also, you have the ability to do all of the normal schema checks and quality checks you would do in code. We have these like decorators essentially that allow us in our pipelines and code to do things like quality checks and verify like data is meeting the schema definition that I have defined, and do that before it's run against the entire pipeline, right? So like we actually want to run simulated tests to verify that the data is not going to break the pipeline. And so Pipeline Builder has this whole set of same defaults turned on for you along with schema validation and change management, which we'll get into in a little bit, that really allow you to achieve quality. And that's actually like a huge thing because that is the thing that kills most of these initiatives, period. Whether you build the pipeline in code or you build the pipeline visually through an interface like Pipeline Builder, is that a lack of quality kills the entire project. It costs companies gazillions of dollars, and that is a huge reason, the primary reason for like the 85% failure rate in all ML and AI initiatives. So I think that, and I believe that's from Gartner, by the way, that stat. It might be 80, but in any case, there's this massive 80 to 85% failure rate in all ML and AI initiatives, primarily because we can't get the data in a decent format to do anything meaningful with it. So again, this is amazing stuff. And by the way, this documentation is public. I'm going to leave links in the description to the documentation. So if you want to go in and read it, you can. And I will be covering Pipeline Builder in great detail on the channel. And with that, let's jump into some more topics. So one of the biggest advantages to Pipeline Builder is the target user, right? So the target user is a data analyst or a high-level engineer slash programmer. Someone who understands like SQL probably, understands relationships between data, but isn't a data engineer. And that's really important because data engineering is one of the fastest growing occupations in engineering overall. 50% year over year growth reported in 2020. The trend is continuing and everyone is competing for them. And it's actually proving to be a bottleneck in ML as well. There's a great article on LinkedIn, which I'll leave a description to, which talks about how there's actually a slowdown in the hiring of data scientists and an increase in the hiring of data engineers, particularly because like, unless you have data quality, you can't do data science. And if you've been watching this channel, I talk a lot about that. And so this is driving a lot of competition for data engineers. They're hard to find, they're highly paid, they're in huge demand. And that's a bottleneck now to the science. And this is a huge problem. We have to remove the engineering bottleneck. Again, if you watch this channel, I often say that Foundry, a lot of Foundry's value proposition is removing the engineering bottleneck and empowering non-technical people to make data-driven decisions. And so by empowering a group of people who can now build pipelines that would have traditionally been created by highly paid, highly in-demand data engineers, what Palantir is doing is fixing the data engineer bottleneck problem. Seattle Data Guy talks a lot about this. I'll leave a link to his channel too. He does a great job too if you want to become a data engineer. Great channel to start your career and get really good information. But also he put out a LinkedIn post recently where he showed kind of, he borrowed from me this hourglass that we have now in engineering, where it's basically like everything is bottlenecking at the engineering point where we want to make a data-driven decision because we can't get the data formatted correctly. We can't get it into a way in which a decision maker could look at it and analyze it, or a model could look at it and analyze it. But he put out this hourglass figure showing how data, and we are bottlenecking at the data engineer right now in data science. And so Pipeline Builder solves that problem. And that is huge because there is a lot of business being tied up in that, not just machine learning, but people who are corporate, like if you're an enterprise consultancy and you need to go and understand where you can improve a customer's business, how you can solve real problems for them. Often you want to just go straight to the data, right? Like, you don't want to necessarily work within the systems that they're using. You want to look at what the data says. You're going to bypass all the UI layer of an ERP system or whatever. And maybe you're in mergers and acquisitions and you want to do the same thing. You don't want to look at the report that they're giving you. You want to get directly into their financial systems, directly into their data. And there's a real bottleneck there, and that cost hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars. And so by unlocking that data, empowering an analyst and empowering like an engineer maybe who's good in JavaScript or React or what, any other high level language, to come in and build a production grade pipeline is massively beneficial. And so like an initiative that might have taken a year or maybe it would have taken 6 months, you can do in 6 days, right? So like, that's the kind of power that's in this tool, and it's differentiated in a lot of ways. We're going to get into the differentiation in a second, but I wanted everyone to understand, like, what is the reason we need a product like Pipeline Builder? Well, it's actually coming along at the exact right time where there's a massive bottleneck in data engineering. Everyone is competing for data engineers, and it's blocking high value, high growth initiatives that have huge amounts of revenue tied to them. And it's not just data science. It's a lot of enterprise consulting and digital transformation and mergers and acquisitions, whole lot of other things out there that need this data to thrive, to let those initiatives thrive and get unblocked. So there is a massive need for this product, and it can't be understated. So what differentiates Pipeline Builder from other products that have come before it? And there have been a lot. Like, there is no shortage of visual workflow tools, pipeline building tools. They've been around for a while. I think the first and foremost that stands out to me in Pipeline Builder, one is just the user experience is incredible, right? So you do have a quality, modern user experience. The other is that it bakes insane defaults to achieve quality by default. And so like, one of the biggest challenges with any visual tool is that typically as the pipeline becomes more and more complex, the usefulness of the tool goes down. So there's this negative correlation between project complexity and the usefulness of the tool. And that exists across almost any visual tool, whether it's like you're building business process automation or you're modeling data pipelines, whatever it is, these point and click UI tools tend to be negatively correlated, where as complexity goes up, usefulness goes down. And that is actually, there is a scientific reason for that, and it revolves around the use of a domain-specific programming language versus a Turing-complete programming language. And this negative correlation, like a DSL or domain-specific language, is meant to do specific things, like specific tasks. It can't do every task. A Turing-complete language, like the languages we typically use to program in, they can do all categories of tasks. So anything the computer can do, you can pretty much do through these Turing complete languages. That's kind of the ducks and bunnies version. And so as you add complexity, you run into these walls with domain specific languages where like, oh man, it can't do this. I really need it to do this. I can kind of hack it together this way. And eventually, you know, the argument goes, you fail to achieve quality, the language breaks down, the usefulness of the tool breaks down, and it just crumbles under the weight of real complexity. And so you know how engineers make this argument all the time, right? And so what differentiates Pipeline Builder is I don't see that negative correlation taking place, because number one, the thing that typically hurts a project is quality, right? So like, as complexity goes up, quality also tends to go down. And the way you achieve quality in engineering specifically is the use of these Turing complete languages to provide test automation, quality controls, continuous integration, so that you know when you broke something before you make the change, right? And with these DSLs, you typically can't do that. And they tend to be brittle as a result. But with Pipeline Builder, you get a whole set of quality checks with same defaults turned on for you automatically. And this is the big part and the thing that differentiates Foundry overall, you have continuous integration built in from day zero, right? So like, having a continuous integration platform that does change management, pull request review, quality check and test automation, so you know what you break before you make the change, built into the platform. You don't have to build it. You don't have to engineer it. It's just there and it's on, is a game changer. And that is going to be the differentiating factor. The other is that it can scale with complexity, right? So like, again, with these DSLs, typically the problem is no one thought about how do you scale this thing to a fairly complex size. It can scale with complexity. It allows you to visually manage your pipelines in a way in which you can get a pipeline with thousands of objects in it and hundreds of transforms or whatever it is you're doing. So it is built to scale. The other is that it's not a trade-off. This is the great differentiator about Pipeline Builder, is it's not a trade-off between a domain-specific language and a Turing-complete language. If you do reach the limits of Pipeline Builder, you can export it to Java, right? So, like, problem solved, right? So, like, and it what's great about it is not just you're getting this bundle of JavaScript code, you can promote it to a code repository in Foundry where you are using the same change management systems, the same quality control methods that you were already using. So you get this seamless transition for your engineers if the DSL ever broke down. So let's get to this point about the domain-specific language in Pipeline Builder, because it's also a differentiator and one of the things that I really love about it. Because what it does, like the GUI, the UI, is just a point-and-click interface to start building up this domain-specific language. It's based on a DAG, or directed acyclic graph, which allows them to do automation through graph theory, where they can figure out, like, essentially which things should be ordered in a particular way to get the most efficiency out of this graph that I've built. And so they have some ways to use this DAG to get efficiency gains, but also the DSL itself allows you to automate a lot of things. So, like, I don't have to use a GUI to produce the pipeline. I could actually just go straight to the DSL and write automation myself that produces the pipeline. And more importantly, I can serialize the pipeline and reuse it all over the place, right? So, like, having this domain-specific language in Pipeline Builder is a huge differentiator, because A, it'll enable developers like me to write automation to just build pipelines out of the DSL without using the GUI, and then hand that off to a team who's using the GUI, right? And why does that matter? Because I can make data archetypes to solve common problems. So if I was working with consultants, enterprise consultancies, or if I was working with companies doing M&As, I could hand them data archetypes for the common systems they're looking at and the way they want to visualize the data in a way that's efficiently modeled. So, like, I'm not burning compute, I'm not wasting resources, I'm handing an efficient archetype that's proven to work with the systems they want to model and the way they want to see the data. And because this is fully serializable, it can be imported into Foundry, imported into Pipeline Builder, and just applied to the source data with a point-and-click interface, which is great, because it's actually a little bit of a step up over templates, Foundry templates. Templates are a little harder to connect to source data if you don't know what you're doing. But with Pipeline Builder, what's great is there's assumptions that the sources are already connected, which exist in Foundry templates, but they're visually there for you to look at, whereas in templates, you can't, like, visually connect the dots. If I serialize a data archetype and bring it into Pipeline Builder, all the person has to do is point and click to connect the source data attributes to my inputs, or connect the source data to my inputs in the pipeline. Super easy to do, super powerful, huge differentiator. And the copy paste, this also enables copy paste. Because they're using a DSL, it's fully serializable. I can go around copying elements of my pipeline, bring them into a new pipeline, and just point and click and connect, which is a huge efficiency gain. And I actually prefer this for myself. Like, I probably won't work as much in code repositories as far as data engineering goes in Foundry, because I'm not a data engineer. I don't know Spark that much. I'm doing a lot of Googling. I don't program in Python every day. I rarely use it. So for me, it's a huge efficiency boost. I can just make I can build my pipelines way faster now as a result of all of these things. And I actually see that being a huge win for any company who has, like, React engineers, high level engineers who don't know Spark, who don't know necessarily Python, and you want them to be productive in Foundry because they know all the other underlying concepts, because they know SQL, they know what arrays are, they know what functions are, they know how to apply all these concepts. And they can just come into Pipeline Builder and now immediately 10x those skills to be that highly paid, highly sought after data engineer, right? So, like, that is also game changing. So, like, my eyes just lit up when I saw this thing. I was like, oh, you have a DSL. It's based on a DAG. You can get DAG efficiencies and optimizations. You're not making a trade-off between a DSL and a Turing complete language. It's going to empower my analysts. It's going to empower my other engineers. And we can finally remove that fucking bottleneck in data engineering. And so that is a game changer. And I do believe they'd solve this in a differentiated way. I do not believe, based on my experience so far, that this is just like another tool that you would get from somewhere else. It's not. And again, it's all about quality. They have continuous delivery baked in so you can achieve high levels of quality. You don't get a negative correlation between complexity and usefulness. So this is fully differentiated, in my opinion, and I will demo it on my channel. So it's coming up soon. I will rebuild Foundry for Gaming on top of Pipeline Builder. I've also got some other things I want to show in enterprise modeling that I'm working on, and that can really demonstrate the power of this thing. So stay tuned for that. So what are my thoughts, final thoughts here? First, I want to say thank you to everyone at Palantir for giving me access to Pipeline Builder. Kamran, thank you so much for walking me through the platform. Hats off to the whole team. Like, this is really an amazing product. you know, one of the things I often love about Palantir is like when I meet their engineers, they're these young people, they're full of enthusiasm typically, and they're like little junior executives, you know, like they know their product inside and out. They know what they're trying to achieve. They know how they're driving business value, which is a rare thing in engineering. So yeah, man, I really think there's something in the water over at Palantir. The engineers are just incredible. So hats off to all of you over there. Keep up the good work. And I do think, again, this is a highly differentiated product that is going to drive billions in business value. So hats off to the team. Thank you everyone so much. And I will see everyone next week.